Today, I would like to delve into a part of my childhood that I hold near and dear to my heart. The year was 2006. I was going into GameStop to look at some used games before it devolved into the shit gimmick-ridden hellscape and toxic point system hell that we all know and hate today. When there, I spotted in the corner of my eye a game called Fantastic Four. A super cool space adventure about three astronauts and one dipshit who got caught in the middle of a cosmic storm that altered their DNA. Mr. Fantastic, my fucking god, how did he go with that name, was given the power of extreme flexibility and the ability to stretch at great lengths, and become a shitty internet meme all at the same time. Sue Storm was given the power of invisibility and generating force fields, making her a great member of this team for defending against attacks. The Human Torch, who, I shit you not, was played by the actor of fucking Captain America, was a cocky dipshit who was pretty much the 2005 archetype of edgy wannabe bad boy energy. And then there was Ben Grimm.
No, Pip, it's clobbering time.
Was by far one of my favorite superheroes, aside from the pussy destroyer Boys of Wild, who was irresistible in every way. Yes, the vast majority of the population was roasting the ever-loving hell out of unimportant characteristics of the movie, like plot and character development and acting, the fucking noobs. But little did I know of the wonders that such a game on the Nintendo GameCube could bring to me all throughout my entire childhood. That is until the game glitched the fuck out and I kept fucking dying because it was impossible to beat the goddamn mole man and get past that force field to hack the fucking computer thing. Fuck you, Marvel. Fuck you, Activision. Fuck all of you. Anyways, time for a Marvel Legends review. Dun, 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 dun!
Hey, give me this, Mickey.
Now I know that everyone and their grandma absolutely hated the 2005 live-action movie. Believe me, I've seen enough Caravan of Garbage to know where this shit's going. But honestly, I unironically love the thing. Fight me, bitch! Ben Grimm being played by Michael Chiklis was an absolute 10 out of 10 performance. Maguire Spider-Man? Weak shit. But there's been such a yearning in my soul to get a nicely articulated and high-quality figure of the Thing for such a long time, and I have to say, this figure might have gotten me into Marvel Legends permanently. The first thing I want to talk about is how much this figure weighs, man. The bubble card on this thing weighs more than an average leader-class box. This thing's heavier than Siege Ultra Magnus, a figure that retails for $50. And well, yes, I understand this figure has to transform and has several gimmicks and accessories that it has to accommodate. When you weigh these two against each other, I feel like this thing is so much more worth the $22 than Siege Ultra Magnus was worth the full $50. The texturing and sculpting on this figure is absolutely top-notch. From the head sculpt displaying the gorgeous baby blue eyes and Ninja Turtles or 1990s Marvel Comics style of gritting of teeth, or the completely zoned-out neutral expression that looks like he's reacting to the existential horror of the fan-forced movie from 2014 and the war crimes behind its existence, I feel like a head sculpt like this can absolutely define a figure, and I have to say, this thing absolutely captures the spirit and essence of not just the Thing, but the Marvel 1990s vibe as a whole. The individually sculpted stone-like texture of his skin just honestly hits different. Like, yeah, Transformers get sculpting pretty good, but hot damn, this boy rocks. It blends in so well that when I got this thing out of the box, I didn't think it'd be able to move because I couldn't see any part separation, so I couldn't tell where the hell the joints were. And I have to say, the methods that Marvel Legends use to hide the fact that their action figures are figures is absolutely genius. They make the internal mechanisms of the joint have the same level of sculpted detail as the outside of the figure, and they color match it perfectly so that the only area I could see any part separation at on this figure is the upper torso. So, to allow for his absurd level of articulation and the fist that can be replaced by an extra pair of open hands. I really wish Transformers had the gall to do something cool like having replaceable battle damage parts that could be swapped out without impeding the transformation. extra limbs are such an undervalued feature that so many action figure lines are doing that I wish Transformers would just catch on already. Now, before anyone flips their shit and says, "But stop motion reviewer, Marvel Legends figures can't transform. You can't compare two different things based on objective qualities because they have different features. You're an overeating moron who should be on YouTube." I understand that Transformers are a completely different thing from Marvel Legends figures. They aren't trying to be just poseable action figures, they have to be two separate things, and I understand that. But at the end of the day, it feels like Marvel Legends figures are giving you everything they possibly can within their budgetary constraints, despite the fact that their prices have to go up. It feels like Transformers are cutting the size of their figures in half every year, making them more hollow, and then charging us $2 or $3 more every year. Honestly, when I was moving the joint on this figure for the first time, I was scared shitless because I forgot that there are certain figures that are durable enough to the point where you can apply any kind of force on the thing without it basically disintegrating in your hands. I'm so used to having to be so ridiculously careful with Transformers that I forgot what it was like to hold a quality action figure in hand. Speaking of the joints, Marvel Legends figures apparently have a fucking ton of them. The fact that something with a stature like this can be this goddamn poseable is absolutely ridiculous. Well, yes, the head is somewhat hampered by the fact that it's too dummy thick to even fit in his own body. The fact this thing has ab crunch, back arch with side to side tilt, and a double waist rotation is positively absurd. Every joint that could possibly be double jointed on this figure is double jointed. And I don't know if this is just the average expectation of a Marvel Legends collector, but hot goddamn, this figure just... Man, this thing just does it for me. I don't know what it is, but I feel like the quality on this thing is so much better than a Transformer that you would be paying the same price for. And it makes me both insanely happy that I found a new facet of collecting for me to engage with, but at the same time it makes me feel really fucking sad about the quality of Transformers going so downhill over the years. At the end of the day, I really do feel like Marvel Legends figures just get it, man. They're high quality, premium, poseable action figures that have incredibly durable and smooth moving joints and capture the spirit and essence of the character in excruciating detail. And if the worst thing I've gotten out of the Marvel Legends retro line of Fantastic Four so far is a slightly wonky head sculpt on Invisible Woman, I can most certainly live with that in comparison to the shit that I've been dealing with. I cannot recommend this figure enough. It is such an absolute godsend. And yes, I understand that there's a Walgreens exclusive or two that are out there that have much deeper and thicker paint with a blackwash effect that really helps the stones to pop more. I feel like this is my definitive version of the character. Have I convinced you that I know anything about Marvel yet? Because I fucking don't. Now, if you excuse me, I have about, let's say, 15 fucking years of films to catch up on. Do I even have to say it? I'm going to.
Our worlds are in danger. To save them and the galaxy, we must...
Oops!